Everybody, come on. It's great to see you this morning. Come on, let's stand and sing.
Not me. Song. Yeah. look at our hearts this morning, Holy Spirit, and see that we have indeed made Jesus the center of this service. There's nothing we desire more than you. Jesus at the center of it all. Jesus at the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus. At the center of it all, oh, it's where you belong. Jesus at the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus, and nothing else. Center of my life, oh yes. Jesus, be the center of my life. Oh. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus. Shall confess to Jesus.
Church, I wonder how many of us have been in a crowd, and we're maybe at a carnival or fair or in the shopping mall, and you suddenly become distracted, and you may look down or you may look away, and you're following who you think is your dad or your mom, and suddenly you look up and you realize, oh my goodness, that is a complete stranger. You know, sometimes distraction can cause us to lose what we love. The Bible tells a story of Mary and Joseph and their relatives going to the Passover festival, and the Passover festival is completed, and they begin to journey back home, and they make an assumption that Jesus is among the relatives, and after one day's travel, they suddenly begin to look for Jesus. They say you look through the relatives and they can't find him, and obviously they're a bit worried, and so they make their way back to Jerusalem, and 3 days later they find Jesus in his father's house and engaging with the Pharisees and religious leaders. But the amazing thing is that somehow they forgot about Jesus. Somehow distraction caused them to leave him behind. And it's not that they didn't love Jesus, of course. He was their son. They loved him very dearly. But distraction caused them to lose sight of him. Distraction caused them to lose Jesus. And I wonder how many of us have allowed distraction in our life, and Jesus has suddenly moved outside of the center. Jesus maybe moved to the side. Come on, as we begin to sing again, I want to encourage you, I want to challenge you. Can we bring Jesus back to the center? You know, it's not that you haven't loved him, it's not that you've lost love for him, but sometimes distraction gets in the way. Come on, let's put Jesus back in the center this morning. Come on, God, we just thank you, God. We thank you, Jesus, that you are the center of our lives. God, you're the building block. God, you're the cornerstone. God, you are our Savior, the one we love dearly, God. This morning, God, we put you back in the center. Come on, church, just sing. Forgive us when we let distraction come in the way. Forgive us for letting distraction make us lose sight of you. This morning, God, we put you back in the center, where you rightfully belong. We put you on the throne of our lives again, Jesus. Because we love you. We want to follow you. We want to seek you. We want to seek first your kingdom and your righteousness, God. In Jesus' name, everybody say it. Amen. Awesome, man. What a great morning. What great worship. Hey, you guys can grab a seat. Well, it is amazing to have you in church this morning. If you are here for the first time, I want to say a very special welcome to you. You're so welcome here. If you have not received a pack of information on our church, then why don't you pop up your hand right now. One of the ushers will see you. They'll bring you some information, help you in your journey, help you feel welcome. We also have a very special visitors lounge, a guest lounge, for those that are new. And that's just outside our doors on the right. And we'd love to have you there, give you a coffee and something sweet. So right after the service, why don't you join us there, and some of our team will be there greeting you and making you feel welcome, and sharing about the church with you. Hey, if you're a kid and you're still hanging around Voltage, intermediate age, or Power Zone, primary school age, someone in the back will love to lead you to that program and help you find your way there. So if that's you, why don't you head out right now. But we want to celebrate. Anybody love to celebrate? And what better way to celebrate than with some chocolate? If you don't like chocolate, then I'm not sure. what's going on. But if you've had a birthday or a wedding anniversary, why don't you come up and celebrate with us? I'm going to ask my lovely wife, Abigail, to come along and hand out some chocolate. She doesn't like being called Abigail, but it's okay. It's okay. What are you celebrating?
Our son got engaged on Friday night to a lovely lady, Hayla Bennett.
Awesome, congratulations. So excited. Would you like some chocolate with that? Go for it. Take two, why not? Why not? Give them, yeah.
It's my granddad's 70th birthday today.
Awesome, happy birthday. Enjoy the rest of your day, Washington.
Rebecca's birthday today.
Awesome, happy birthday, Rebecca. Claudia?
Me and Bethany are doing the 40-hour famine.
Oh, good work. So that means we can't give you chocolate, eh? I suppose you're going to have it afterwards. You'll have it afterwards. Okay, leave without it. That's cool.
It was Eva's first birthday yesterday, so she
turned 21. Awesome. Happy birthday, Eva. Thank you. Amy?
The birthday
in the week. Awesome. Happy birthday, Amy. How are you going?
Birthday yesterday.
Oh, happy birthday. All the birthdays going around. We'll save you guys for last because we want to pray for you. Is that cool? Awesome. Christian, come on out.
No, I don't have a birthday or anything. I just want to celebrate Street Pastors has grown from just over a year ago, two people going out on a Saturday night. We've now got about 12 people plus people making soup. And as of next week, we'll be going every fortnight. So it's just a testament to God's grace and how He's grown this amazing ministry.
So good, Christian. You're doing a great job. Want some chocolate? No chocolate, okay.
Birthday on Wednesday.
Birthday Wednesday. Happy birthday.
How many years?
49. Congratulations, awesome. So good. What are you celebrating?
Yesterday I just like to thank all those people who helped me move yet again in the rain.
Awesome. Great, Michelle.
Now I'm the second daughter, so I'm not 49, because that's my parents and it's their 49th wedding anniversary, and I'm not 49, but this is my birthday.
Awesome, congratulations. Deborah, did you want to share for a minute?
Julie and I are moving to Greece. And we're going on Wednesday and we're going back to my family's island. And in the first instance for rest and recreation and just, you know, a time of healing. We're meeting all of Jodie's five sisters there. And so we won't be back for a while. We may be gone for some time. But one thing I just had on my heart to say was that don't be daunted. Know the armour, put it on every day, and fix your eyes on Jesus because He's coming.
Well, can we reach out our hands and pray for these guys? God, we just thank you for this amazing family. And we just pray for safe travels as they head over to Greece. God, we pray that it would be an amazing time. God, recapture, reconnecting with all the daughters and sisters. And it would be an amazing family reunion, God. And God, we just pray for your provision, for anything they need, God. They would lack no good thing, God, but you'd provide for them, God. We just pray for your amazing blessing, your protection, and your anointing on them as they go. In Jesus' name. Everybody said? Amen. Amen. Awesome, guys. Awesome. Hey, I'm just going to take up the giving in a second. And I've just got a verse to read. And it's Paul quoting Jesus, and it's from Acts. And he said, "It is more blessed to give than to receive. It is more blessed to give than to receive." And I think sometimes we read these verses and it sort of gives us, you know, like a warm feeling. Or, oh, that's awesome, you know. And, you know, oh, when I give, I'm more blessed than I am to receive. And we can sort of just glance over them or sort of take it for granted as it's one of those, you know, one of those things that Jesus said that's quite cool, you know, it makes us feel good. But the reality is that Jesus said nothing. Jesus didn't say anything for the sake of saying it. You know, everything Jesus said, He says for a reason. And so when He says that when we're more blessed to give than we are to receive, He's actually saying, actually, there is a blessing that comes with giving. There is a transaction. There is something that happens when we give. You see, when we start to live generously, there's something that happens on the inside of us that is transforming us, that is making us more like His image. So that as we begin to live generous lives, that we begin to display God's glory in a way that we've never done before. We begin to reflect His image in a new way. We begin to reflect His image like we've never done before. And so as we give, come on, let's believe this. Let's hang on to this promise. Let's take it for ourselves that when we give, it's not just a, oh, you know, if we give, we'll give back. But actually, there's something happening inside of us. That there's a transformation that happens. It's a step of faith. an expectation that God is going to be transforming us and working in our lives. Is that good this morning, church? Come on, let's pray together. God, we just thank you, God, that you are so generous. God, that you've created us in your image, and as we begin to live out in generosity, God, as we begin to take a step of faith, God, you are transforming us, God. You're renewing us, and you're working in us, God, to make us more like you, God. You say that those who you've chosen, God, you've predestined to be conformed to the likeness of your Son. God, would you conform us to the likeness of your Son? And thank you for the good work that you started in us, God, that you're going to be faithful to complete. In Jesus' name, everybody said?
Amen.
Amen. Hey, we've got a couple of notices for you this morning. Boundary scores. If you've got trouble saying no, which a lot of us do, you know, there's a lot of areas in our life that we can struggle to say no. And a boundaries course is really, really great. It's a great course. It's starting on Wednesday, the 3rd of June at 7 p.m. There's a cost of $40 per person, but that includes all the resources and the manual and everything you need. So I encourage you, if this is an area that you need to improve in, why not take a boundaries course? It's going to be a great course. All teams night is for everybody that serves in any area of the church any day of the week. So if you're in mums and bards or maybe music or wherever you serve, all teams night is for you, and it's going to be happening on the 7th of June right here in the auditorium at 6 p.m. So come along to that. I believe there's no need to RSVP or anything like that. You just show up. It's going to be a great night. It's going to be a real good time praising and worshipping together. Pastor Mike's got a great word to share. So make sure you come up for that. It's going to be a great night. Water baptisms. If you haven't been baptized, I encourage you, this is a step for you. Baptism is a great step, and we do it simply in obedience to Christ. You know, even Jesus got baptized by John, and he said that, you know, that it was right for him to do that. And so I encourage you, if you haven't been baptized, what are you waiting for? Sign up at the info booth or sign up with Avon Park during the week. It's happening on the 14th of June. It's going to be a great service. It's always exciting, having baptisms in the morning and during praise and worship, and the atmosphere is unbelievable. So make sure you see Yvonne, she'll sign you up for that. Also, if you need any more information, make sure you check out our website and our Facebook group and page. It'll give you all the information you need and keep you up to date. Well, that's it from me. I'm going to pass the mic over to Pastor Mike, and he's got a great message for us this morning. I know, it's a bit cheesy, but here we go.
Fantastic. Hey, thanks, Adrian. How are we doing? Anyone had a good week? Anyone had that promise kind of percolating in your heart over the last week and trusting that promise, going in on it? I hope so. How many people invited somebody to church in the last week? Because I said if you invite people to church, I might read one of my Valentine's Day cards to Amy. So I'm going to need at least a half a dozen people that invited somebody to church. Okay, I'm in trouble. All right. To my precious darling, I'm so in love with you. You are so beautiful, and I love every part of you. And I did a little Song of Solomon's pickup line in there. I just wish we were both a little older. I was about 18 at the time. I know we're right for each other, and I'm committed to you forever. That's where we'll leave it for now. So I was reading through some of them going, oh my goodness, they are so cheesy. So it was like unbelievably bad. But anyway. We're not going to read from these words this morning. How about we read from the Bible? Love the Bible. How many people love the Word of God? How many people believe it can change our lives? As long as we open it, read it, and then apply it. So we're going to do a bit of that this morning. Is that all right? We're going to go to Joshua chapter 1, verse 1. Joshua, one of my favorite characters in the Bible, one of my favorite books in the Bible, probably because when that command is given, be strong and courageous, that pretty much sums up most of us, because we're all a little bit afraid and we need some strength and courage in our lives. So we're going to read from there this morning, Joshua 1 verse 1 through to verse 8. It says, after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord said to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' aide, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now then, you and all these people get ready to cross the Jordan River into the land I'm about to give them. To the Israelites, I will give you every place where you set your foot as I promised Moses. Your territory will extend from the desert to Lebanon, from the great river the Euphrates, all the Hittite country to the Mediterranean Sea in the west. No one will be able to stand against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Be strong and courageous, because you will lead these people to inherit the land I swore to their ancestors to give them. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the law my servant Moses gave you. Do not turn from the right or to the left, that you may be successful wherever you go on it. Keep this book of the law always on your lips. Meditate it on a day and night, so you'll be careful to do everything written in it. Then you'll be successful and prosperous. Good promise, isn't it? Let's pray this morning. Father, we thank you. We do thank you for your word. Lord, that if we would take it into our lives, if we would apply it to our lives, Lord, it changes us and it changes the circumstances around us. Father, I pray that, Lord, as we grab a hold of the attitude that Joshua had, Lord, would we find ourselves in a place of walking into your promises, into your success for our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We're going camping this morning. Is that all right? Going camping this morning. But first of all, I want to ask you a question. How many people have been in love? How many people are still in love? I hope those hands stay up there. Yeah. How many people would like to be in love? Because we can set that up too. We're pretty good. Church, you can find everything. You can find a spouse. You know? You can find what you're looking for here in church. But I want us to journey back. Some of those of you, how many people have been married 5 years? 10 years, 15 years, anyone 20 years plus married? Fantastic. I want you to go back, okay, back in the day when you were in love with the person and you weren't married yet, okay, you were dating, you were trying to win their affection. I was asked a question, actually, before I get into that, I was asked a question, do I still write cards to Amy? Our love's matured. It's gone to another level. See, when you get married, your love kind of matures. Is it text? Is it email? No. I pour out my love with a double shot latte in the morning. How many people know that coffee is a love language? Yeah. So I pour out my love through coffee. There we go. You can excuse you. What about when you were dating? You would take the one you love out for a meal. It's raining, middle of winter. So you get to the restaurant and it's pouring down with rain. So you get out of the car, you go grab your jacket, you put it over your spouse and you kind of, well, not spouse yet, the person you're dating, take them into the restaurant, you're getting absolutely drenched, you sit down to order the meal and you've just got water that's gone down your back, into your undies, down into your socks. And are you okay? You look cold. No, darling, you smile, it's all the warmth I need. Yeah, you're like, yeah. Then it comes to ordering off the menu, and you order a meal that you can eat together. So when she asks, darling, do you like your aubergine and tofu pizza? You go, of course, it's almost as delicious as your smile. Then it comes to choosing the movie, and you say, chick flick? Who doesn't love a good chick flick? Yeah? Yeah, you say what needs to be said, and you do anything that you need to do to win the affection of the one you love. Now, fast forward a few years, you got the ring on the finger. She's yours. On the odd occasion you do take her out for a meal, she's on her own. You get to the restaurant, and because you're quicker than her, you can get to the shelter before she can. And you've got the remote control, so you can just hit the lock it up. You don't have to wait for her to get all of her stuff. And then she finally gets there, and she's drenched. Now, I've learned the secret to success in the ordering from the menu is you order what you want to eat, and then get her to order what you want to eat. Let me explain. So we went out the other night, and I really liked the look of the eye fillet. It looked just absolutely amazing. And I thought, what would be really good with that is the side of risotto. And so I ordered the steak and managed to use my persuasive skills to encourage Amy to also order the risotto. So that meant when I ate my meal and she didn't eat all of hers, I got to eat some of hers. Some of the guys are with me on that. Now, when it comes to choosing the movie, this is where you can really win, guys. I'm giving you a clue here. You actually organise the chick flick, but you let them go out with their girlfriend, because that's what chick flicks are for. So, yeah, hey, babe, why don't you go out for a night with your girls? You know, go out for dinner and go out and watch a movie together. You don't have to tell her that the All Blacks are playing. And you can watch that at home when she goes out, but you get brownie points, right? Preach it. I heard a preacher. Come on, if your husband's just a little bit guilty, just give him a subtle nudge and say, I still love you. Still love you. But when you're in love with someone, you will do absolutely anything for them. Honey, will you make me a cup of tea? Absolutely. You rub my back? Absolutely. Are you going to get a vasectomy? Wait, what? Let's get back to the Word of God, eh? In this passage, Joshua 1 effectively says, you want success? You want to be successful in life? Obey. You want to be successful in life? Obey everything that's written in the law, in the Bible. At a glance, we read that and we go, what kind of relationship is that? You want success, you've got to be obedient. Well, that doesn't sound like a good relationship. So let's explore this passage a little bit. In this All-In series last week, we're kind of looking at the Batman and Robin of the Old Testament, Joshua and Caleb. You know, they went in, they were two of the spies of the 12 that went in to go and bring back a kind of a report of the land. And their purpose was to come back and say, there are strongholds and these are the places that they're vulnerable and we'll go in and we'll go and win the land. So Joshua and Caleb went in, they brought back a good report. 10 spies came back with a bad report. As a result, the Israelite people had to wander through the wilderness for another 40 years. Joshua and Caleb were promised the promised land. And they stuck in there. We learned last week that Caleb, he trusted the promise and he went all in. He was wholeheartedly committed to the promise that God had over his life. And he went and he got the land in the end. This morning, we're going to look at Joshua. And we're going to discover why Joshua was chosen as the leader and not Caleb. We're going to learn that a lifestyle of love and obedience leads to success. Love and obedience leads to success. Why was Joshua chosen? Because when you look at it, Caleb was the one really that stood up in front of the people and said, hey, we can take this land. He kind of showed that leadership gift, didn't he, in a lot of ways, standing up and going, hey, we can do this. But why did Joshua get chosen? Now, I've read the Bible since I was 3, you know, picture Bibles, and I read this passage we're about to read many, many times before one day I actually saw what it was saying. Anyone found that with the Word? Sometimes you've read it, and you've read it, and you've read it, and then all of a sudden, God just pulls it out. This wisdom, this understanding. That's why it's living and active. It's here today. It can change us if we read something new today. Exodus 33 verse 11, it says, the Lord would speak to Moses face to face as one speaks to a friend. Then Moses would return to the camp, but his young aide Joshua, son of Nun, did not leave the tent. He did not leave the tent. Moses went home, he checked out, but Joshua, he stayed in the tent. Joshua loved God with such a passion. He lived a life of love and obedience, which would one day lead to not only his success, but the success of the Israelite people. Yeah. Now, in modern terms, Joshua was a PA. He basically was a personal assistant to Moses. So he'd shine Moses' sandals and get his tunic ready, and probably updated all of his appointments on his iPad, and brought him his Manichino in the morning. And, you know, so he was there as Moses' aide. And so all he had to do was his job and then go home at the end of it. But no, Joshua wanted to stay. Now, can you imagine this with me? Because if you go back to verse 7, Moses would pitch a tent outside of the camp. Now, all the others, they had their tents a little bit like this maybe. Thanks, Christian and Barbie. Appreciate the tent. So they would come out of their tent as Moses would go to this tent of meeting. The cloud, the pillar of cloud would come down on that tent. And they would worship. The people would come out of their own tent, see Moses coming, they'd see God, the presence of God fall, and then they would worship and then kind of get on with the day. Maybe go back into their own tent or carry on. Now, I did a bit of research on this. I was trying to work out what was the tent, what was significant about Moses' tent. Was it something special? I mean, it says a tent of meeting, but as I read this passage, I don't believe it was the tabernacle. I'm not talking about the tabernacle here. It says that Moses would pitch a tent. A tent. A little bit like this, probably. And he called it the tent of meeting. It was his tent of meeting. Do you find it fascinating that everybody else was standing in their own tent of meeting, but maybe missing out on that encounter with God like Moses was having? I put out on Facebook a post. I said, you know, as a father of three children now, there is no such thing as a quiet time in my house. You know, it's very difficult to find time where you have that quiet time that you had when you were single. So I kind of put it out there. I said, guys, what do you do for your quiet time? What does that look like with your time with God? How do you connect with God? Effectively, I'm asking the question, what's your tent of meeting? How do you connect with God? What do you do to find that place where you can hear God's voice? Exodus 25, it says, have them make a sanctuary for me and I will dwell among them. You know, the church, what we would call the tabernacle of today, this is where we gather together. We gather together and we meet once a week and maybe during the week in our life groups, but there is a tent of meeting that we need to discover for ourselves that happens every day. At some point of our day, we have to find a way to connect with God. A.W. Tozer, who was a famous author, a pastor in America, this is what he said about the presence of God, God's manifest presence. And if we are to seek God's presence, this is what we will see. The presence and the manifestation of the presence are not the same. There can be the one without the other. God is here when we are wholly unaware of Him. He's right here even when we don't notice Him. He is manifest only when and as we are aware of His presence. Something shifts in our head, in our heart, when we recognize that He is here. It's like a transaction that goes on between God and our spirit. On our part, there must be surrender to the Spirit of God. For His work, it is to show us the Father and the Son. If we cooperate with Him in loving obedience, God will manifest Himself to us. And that manifestation will be the difference between a nominal Christian life and a life radiant with the light of His face. You want the presence of God? I desperately want the presence of God. It comes out of loving obedience. When we get into a place where we know His voice, when we're there with Him, and there's that intimacy that we get when we are close to the one we love. It's Pentecost Sunday today, as Adrian shared this morning. How did those people get the presence of God, that manifest presence of God that filled the room and every single person, we're told, was filled with the Holy Spirit? They were obedient. What did Jesus say? Go and wait in Jerusalem. So some of them probably got there and by 9:30 God hadn't come. Holy Spirit hadn't come. They were like, I've got other stuff to do. The next day, the day after that, the day after that, the day after that, the day after that. Still nothing. How many people left the room? Even though Jesus said, go and wait, I'm going to send my help, the Holy Spirit. He's going to come, He's going to be your comforter. How many people left because they weren't going to trust that promise? And yet those that waited, those that were obedient, they had that encounter with God that effectively launched the church. 3,000 added to the church. Bang! People can say daily. Not just at church on a Sunday, but every day people were being added to their number. Where did it come from? A lifestyle of love and obedience that led to success, led to salvation, led to healings and miracles and signs and wonders. I asked the question, you know, where's your tent of meeting? How do you connect with God? Some people, amazing how many people connect with God in the shower. Man, funny that. Maybe the evil spirits can't, you know, maybe they're scared of the water. I don't know. But yeah, you connect with God. For me, the most creative times and enlightening times I have is when I'm actually serving Amy in her love language, which is not pouring a cup of coffee, but acts of service. When I'm out mowing the lawns or doing the dishes or the washing or something like that, I actually get a lot of my creativity. A lot of those God moments actually take place in that moment. Some of you drive trucks for a living, and so you put on podcasts and audio Bibles. Some of you, in between feeding children, you're listening to sermons or reading the Bible. Some of you get to sit on the couch at mid-morning and you get to read the Word of God. It doesn't matter how. There's no prescribed formula, but we've got to have a tent of meeting. We're going to have our own place where we can connect with God. Because if not, we don't hear His voice. And we don't then step out in obedience. Now, when I talk to someone on the phone for the first time, I'll call them up. I'll say, hi, it's Mike DeVetta. I'm calling from Elam Christian Centre. I'm the pastor there. I'd like to talk to you about your service. And it's kind of like a formal introduction to our relationship. Never talked to them before. And that's kind of how I would begin my conversation. Now, when I call Amy, I don't call her up and say, hi, Amy, it's Mike DeVetta. I'm your husband, the father of your children. When I call her up, I say, hey, babe. She goes, hey, sexy. Our connection's a bit bad. I think that's what she said to me, so. I don't have to identify myself, do I? Hey, babe. I'm sorry, who is this? It's Mike. Mike who? Yeah, she knows my voice. She knows my voice. How have we developed that relationship? How does she know my voice? We've spent lots of time together. You want to know God's voice? You know what the secret to it is? Spend a lot of time with Him. Get to the point where His voice is so clear. When He says, Mike, I want you to go do something, your response is, I know your voice, God. You've never failed me before, you never will. I trust you. And that's the relationship we want to have with our loving Father. Some of us need to understand that God wants us to win. God wants us to win. He wants to set us up to win. Every day He gives us the opportunity to be successful, to win, to bring people to Christ. He gives us the opportunity. Would we stop and listen? I hope we are. My success or failure is a direct result of my obedience to God or lack of it. Let me say that again. My success or failure is a direct result of my obedience to God or lack of it. When God asks me to do something and I step out, even though it may seem a little strange, God will come through because He's calling. Did God ever ask people to do kind of strange things in the Bible? Quite often. Moses, you know, see that stick you're holding? Throw it on the ground. Turns into a snake. Now go pick up the snake. Kidding. God asked some really weird things of people. Why was Joshua chosen to be the leader of the Israelite people? Because God needed somebody who knew His voice, loved His presence. And so when He asked them to do something crazy, something completely out of the box, Joshua says, all right then. That's my God. I trust you. We want to know God's voice. We've got to spend time with Him. Sometimes, though, we approach obedience with God on our terms. God, I'm ready to serve you. I'm ready to use my gifts to bless the kingdom. God says, I want you to go and talk to that person who's sitting by themselves at church. Just go and love on them. No, God, I don't think you heard me properly. I want to use my gifts to love you and serve you. Give me a microphone. I'm ready to preach or sing or... Well, how about you go preach the gospel to your neighbor? You don't mean my literal neighbor, do you? That was just kind of a story, wasn't it? Love and obedience leads to success. 22 years ago, in a church not far from here, just down the road, our pastor said, we've got a need in the kids' ministry. We need some people to lead the creche. My mum, who's here today, two of us, we said, we can do that. A couple of years, we went and served every Sunday morning, just loving on a bunch of kids. And I love getting there on a Sunday morning, just serving the kids. Had no idea what my journey was going to be. Never knew I'd be here one day doing what I'm doing. But little steps of obedience along the way. And God has brought about different things in my life that's led me to where I'm here today. I just said yes. I got good at saying yes. Got to get boundaries as well. But I got good at saying yes to God. Don't have to talk to God about boundaries. God, I'm setting my boundaries up. No. When He asks you to do something, you don't have to put the whole boundaries line on Him. Okay? There might be other things that you got to get rid of. Sorry, God, I'm just keeping my boundaries right. Good luck with that one. But if you're looking at your life wondering why things aren't moving the way you want them to or getting to where you want to be, sometimes it's a divine delay. There are times where it just hasn't happened because God hasn't ordained for it to happen yet. But I wonder sometimes if we haven't been completely obedient. Here's God's will summed up for your life in 9 simple words. Will change your world forever. You get this right? Tomorrow, the next day, the day after that, everything changes. Do the last thing God asks you to do. That's the will of God. Not the next thing, the last thing. Once you've done that, God will give you the next thing. So I want that promotion at work. I deserve it. God gave me the strategy. He said, pray for your boss. I don't like him. God said, pray for him anyway. Bless him. Serve him. Turn up early rather than just on the clock. Leave late. So I want a better marriage. God gave you the strategy. Pray for your wife. Love her. Serve her. Don't know if we're lying. It's gone quiet here in England this morning. You want to break free from that addiction. Keep finding yourself back in that place again. God gave you the strategy. He says you got to change your circle of friends. You're putting yourself in a place that's unsafe. But you keep going back there. See, God has already given us the secret to our success. But maybe some of us have to go back to the last thing God asked us to do. And how will we do that? Let's go visit God in our tent of meeting. Tomorrow, this afternoon, whatever it looks like for you, will you get yourself into that tent of meeting and say, God, what was the last thing I haven't done that you asked me to do? I've got a really, really, really good feeling with this. I'm confident that 100% of us, if we genuinely ask that question, there'll be one thing. It'll be a relationship. I want peace in my life. I just want peace in my life. Well, God gave you the strategy. A few months ago, he said, you've got to forgive that person. Yeah. You've got to release them from the judgment that you've spoken over their life. Yeah. You want success? Yeah. Love and obedience. Loving obedience. I believe Joshua was chosen because he had a good relationship with God. Joshua woke up one morning and God says, we're going to take on Jericho. Here's how we're going to do it. We can do it a little bit differently. I want the people to walk around Jericho. They're not going to say anything. They're allowed to say anything at all. They're going to march around Jericho. Joshua says, okay. People in Jericho, they're looking at the people of Israel going, you guys are idiots. Throwing rotten fruit and tomatoes. Meanwhile, the people just march silently around Jericho. Big march, got to the end of the day. This is, okay, what are you going to get me to do next, God? Okay, day 2, people. We're going to march again. Right? Day 2. We're going to march around. Can we talk this time? Nope, just silent. Just going to march. Going to march. Going to march. Day 3. Again? Okay, right. Let's keep marching. Day 4. Keep marching. Keep marching. Day 5 comes along. We're going to keep marching. Woohoo! Meanwhile, I mean, you guys are looking at me going, you are an idiot. Making a fool of yourself, Mike. Yeah, okay, all good. Day 6 comes along. I want you to march again. Then they get to 7 and they go, 7, that's a bit of a godly number. Right? They know their Bible numerics. So they get to number 7. Go, this must be it. It's go around 7 times. I'm not going to go around 7 times, it'll be a really long sermon. But why did God choose Joshua to be the leader of the Israelite people? Because I don't think that's a good plan. I'm being honest, I wouldn't have picked that as a plan. A couple of trebuchets, maybe a siege ramp, some fiery arrows, some cannonballs or something.
to take over Jericho, but no. God says, I want you to march around the city for 6 days, once, and then on the seventh day, I want you to march around, and then on the seventh time, I want you to shout, I want the trumpets to blow, and then the walls of Jericho come down. God doesn't always ask us to do something that makes sense to us. God chose Joshua because he developed a lifestyle of love and obedience. His success, the success of the Israelite people, came when he simply walked in obedience. I say it again, what could happen? We talked last week about us being a bunch of grasshoppers. What would happen if God could use a bunch of grasshoppers in this city? What could happen if we went out in the calling that God's put on our life and we just rub shoulders with people, we talk to people, we follow the prompts, we wake up in the morning and we get into our team with God and we say, God, what do you want me to do today? What's on your agenda for me? God says, I want you to just walk out and go and talk to that person. I remember I prayed that prayer. Dangerous prayer to pray. It really is. You say, God, use me today. I dare you. I dare you. Double dare. I pray that prayer. I said, God. If I just get the band to come too. I said, God, what do you want me to do today? And I felt God say, take some money, pop it in an envelope, write a little card, say, God bless you. And just carry it with you. So I did. I carried it around with me. And went to the supermarket and I was going to come do the stealth mission and give it to somebody and then run away. It was just kind of like, felt like I was supposed to be generous to somebody. So I'm walking through the supermarket, and I see somebody and so I start following her. And so we're going through the supermarket and I think, I'm supposed to talk to her. And so I kind of get there and then just as I'm about to give it to her, she starts talking to someone else and so I'm like, kind of go the other direction. And then it's like, well, it mustn't have been God. So I get to the checkout and guess who's in front of me? Yeah, of course. She's still there. Okay, well, here's my opportunity. So she paid for her groceries and then I was just going to go and then she started talking to someone else. I'm like, it mustn't have been God. So I go into the car park and, oh, well, God, you must be setting someone else up. Put my trolley away, turn around, come back to the car and guess who's there? Same lady again. Blue scarf, big jacket on. And I went to give it to her, and I chickened out. I did. Just like, didn't do it. Put the money back in my pocket, went to work the next day. It was about 3 or 4 kilometres from the supermarket I was in. Sitting at my desk preparing my message. Her face comes back to my memory. I see that jacket, and I see that big blue scarf wrapped around her neck. I go, God, I'm so sorry I missed out on that opportunity. Would you bless her in some way? I looked up from my window. It's one of these stories, yeah. There she is, walking down the street. Same jacket, probably the only jacket she has. Blue scarf. I'm like, are you kidding me? I run down the stairs, get out there, and she's gone. And then all of a sudden I see her step out of a shop and she starts walking. So I'm running after her and somebody from our church steps out and goes, hey, Mike. I'm like, not now. Ran up and I said, excuse me, man. I just want to give you something and just say God loves you. She turned to me. I had no idea what's on the envelope. I mean, it could have been anthrax for all I know. Yeah. And she looks at the envelope and tears start streaming down her face. It was like she'd seen an angel. I know I'm kind of good looking, but it was like this moment God had just put his arm around her and hugged her. Obedience. Yes. That's all it was. What would happen if today we walked out of this place? And in a moment I'm going to pray. I'm going to invite you to join me in a dangerous prayer. God, what do you want me to do today? We'll go back and we'll ask what we needed to do, but let's ask, what do you want me to do today? Who do you want me to touch? Who do you want me to impact today? Is anyone brave enough to pray a prayer like that? Anyone? Not everyone will be. That's okay. Don't put your hand up if you're not going to follow through. But in a moment, I'm going to pray that prayer. I'm going to believe that each one of us, God is going to set us up with a God encounter. And when it happens, come on, let's jump on the Facebook page and let's talk about it. Let's tell the story. Let's come up and grab a crunch and go, you'll never believe it. And you've got to do it in 20 seconds, okay, because we'll have 100 stories. You'll never believe what happened when I prayed that prayer. Come on, I want to be a people that are all in, fully committed to the promise of God on our life. And it starts every day in our car, in our house, in our lounge, wherever it is that you meet with God, where you're getting used to hearing His voice, so that when you wake up tomorrow morning and God says, hey Mike, I got something I want you to do, we'll say, rah, let's go for it. That sound all right? You know the word Joshua means the Lord saves, Yahweh saves. Joshua was a forerunner for Jesus. You know, Jesus said, if you love me, you will obey my commands. Another translation says, if you love me, you will be able to. It's like there's an ability to obey when we really love someone. If you love me, then when I ask you to do something, it's easy. See, when Amy asked me to do something, I actually don't go, really? We've got a really good relationship now that when she asked me to do something, as long as it's not between 6:40 and 6:50, which is sports news, as long as she, when she asked me, I'm like, yeah, I can do that. I'd love to do that. I'd love to serve you. So let's build that relationship. But you know what? God loves every single one of us. And there's people here today. Maybe you don't have a relationship with God and you know you need one. It starts with just a simple step of obedience that says, I'm going to surrender my life to you, God. I'm going to lay down my right to lead my life and I'm going to hand that over to you. I'm going to invite you to be Lord of my life. And this morning we want to give you that opportunity. With every eye closed, every head bowed, we want to get you to do something very simple, and that's pray a prayer. If you pray that prayer, the Bible says if you believe in your heart that Jesus is Lord, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, if you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, the promise is you'll be saved. This morning salvation has been offered if some of you would take that step of obedience and say, yes, I receive you, Lord Jesus, today. I accept that gift of salvation. So will you pray that prayer with me this morning, just in your heart? Say, dear Jesus, I surrender my life to you. I'm sorry for living life my own way. Would you come and be Lord of my life? I put my hope and my trust in you. Please forgive me for my sins. Help me to live a life that would honor you. I take the step of obedience today and accept you as my Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Just with every head bowed, eye closed. If you prayed that prayer, you said, this is me today. I'm coming to God for the very first time. Maybe you're returning. Maybe you've been away from Him. And God's challenged you today to come back to Him, to walk in obedience with Him. And that's you. Would you just pop your hand up right now? Say, that's me. Thank you. Someone in the middle there. Awesome. Anyone else? Anyone else? Saying yes. It's great. Thank you. Thank you. Anyone else this morning? You pray that prayer. You said, I'm getting my life right with God again. Last opportunity. Awesome. Awesome. Congratulations. You've taken a significant step. The most important decision you could ever make. Church, I want to pray that prayer, believing that God's going to do something significant in our life today, the moment we walk out of these doors. If that's you, come on, I was courageous enough to walk around the building. Would you stand? I'm not asking everybody to stand. Just if you're prepared to pray this prayer. Why don't you lift your hands to heaven, sign of surrender, submission to God. Say, God, today I trust you. I love you. I love your presence. Would you use me to do whatever you need me to do? Even if it sounds crazy, if it sounds weird, I trust you. Would you use me today to bless somebody? Would you use me today to tell my story? Would you use me today to preach the gospel? Would you use me today to be generous to somebody, to bless somebody? in Jesus' name. Amen. And if you believe that and you're going to go out and do that, you say, amen. Come on, let's worship for a moment. Thanks, Sarah.
Nothing in this world.
Hey, if that message has touched you, impacted you anyway, I want to invite you up for ministry. We've got a phenomenal ministry team that would love to stand with you and pray with you and encourage you. And so if that's you, why don't you come up after the service, receive some ministry. Don't forget, we've got a guest lounge just outside the doors on your right. So if you're joining us for the first time, why don't you go in the guest lounge and grab a coffee and something to eat. We'd love to welcome you there. Also, if you're not in a life group, get in a life group. Life groups are a great way to do life together. And I encourage you to go see the info desk and they'll help you to find a life group that's going to be great for you. And don't forget to be centers of hope to reach, serve, and influence. Grab an invite card, invite somebody to church. I'm really excited to be preaching next week. So come out for that. It's going to be a lot of fun. And have a great day. Enjoy the rest of it. See you later.